Hi, I'm artist Diana Shpungin. We're here in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. Welcome to my studio. I'd love to show you around. These are my flat files, and this is where we store drawings. This is Gerald. Gerald is very important in the studio. He's my studio skeleton and clearly the model for the rotating skull in Still Life Triptych. And these are my pencils and tools and brushes and erasers and things of that nature. This is Sierra, my lovely studio assistant. Say hi, Sierra. And when we have lunch or need to take a break, we come out to the garden. It's nice to have an outdoor space with a lovely view of New York to take a break from the monotonous task of the studio. And this is one of my dog's Pencil. Yes, my dog's name is Pencil. I know it's right on brand, but look at her. It's a perfect name. Stay. So in this series of direct castings of cracked mirrors, I collected numerous broken mirrors over the years, and I cast them in solid paper. I created these at Dudenay Paper, which is a large, well-known paper mill that works primarily with contemporary artists. And the works were cast in reverse, and we pulled very large sheets of pigmented cotton paper pulp in varieties of gray tones, and then we added luminous silver pigment. So when you look at the mirrors and you kind of walk by, there's this hint of a glimmer kind of pointing at the past life of the mirror. I like to think that I both literally and figuratively made a negative a positive. So the negative superstition turned into a positive superstition, and the positive form of the mirror turned into a negative casting of the mirror. So these boarded up window works that you see here, they're also cast paper that I made at Dudenay, and they were all made from individual molds of actual wood. All the screws were also made of paper. The series is called Don't Let the Light In, and it was kind of a bridge from the drawing of a house project. I wanted to create something that lasted from that project, kind of a memory of that project. Drawing of a house was a large, kind of multifaceted, participatory work. It was both a drawing, a sculpture, it had hand-drawn animations, it sort of had everything in it. And I worked with an organization called Site Lab in Michigan, and they gave me this vacant house that was a former Catholic rectory, and it sat abandoned for many, many years. So what we proceeded to do is I kind of cleaned up the house, boarded up the windows, turned it into a kind of minimalist sculpture, and then we had the community participate. We had about 100 volunteers all work on this house for many months, and covering it by hand in graphite pencil from top to bottom. And then at night, the windows would come alive with these hand-drawn animations that I made. Those animations were kind of an ambiguous narrative of that lifespan of the house. So the work for the Aldrich Museum that's on display is Still Life Triptych, and this is one of my pencil animations, and it consists of 280 original source drawings. There's three components. I like to think that ideally it's shown as a triptych, but each work could also function on its own. And I thought about how I was torn between being brave and having anxiety, or being hopeful or hopeless. How we were unified and divided. And I found that time was very strange, how it expanded and compressed, especially during this last year. So what would I make for this show? I ended up making this still life, and I thought about the Memento Mori, the Venetus still life painting by Philip de Champagne from the 1600s. And he depicted a skull, a flower, an hourglass, kind of thinking about the futility of time and the certainty of death. So in the first panel, you see a skull, and the skull is spinning, and you see a landscape in the background that's moving in sequence with the skull, and then in the background you hear a white noise humming. the sound was very important in these pieces because I wanted to create a kind of contemplative, meditative space. And the work in the middle with the hourglass has a background of protesters marching, but it's just their silhouettes. It's purposely ambiguous, so it's more open-ended. There are so many protests that happened in the last few years, especially. I didn't want to keep it to one topic. I wanted anyone who viewed the work to be able to enter into it in different ways. The sound for that particular work was the sound of rain, so yet another sound that you might have on a sleep sound machine or to meditate. And then the last work, you see an iris budding and blooming and dying and rotating in this kind of cycle of life. And I chose an iris because I liked how it symbolized hope and wisdom and courage. And then the background is a chain link fence. So I thought about borders and confinement. And then the sound is the composition that I created of a meditation bell. And so then you hear all these things together and it creates this really kind of soothing space, even though the subject matter is quite difficult. For the second iteration of 2020, the erased 45 that I made is a completely different method of working, where I came across this auction, and they were auctioning off a drawing by our 45th president. And I thought this image was very odd. And so I thought, what would it be like to recreate that drawing, to literally have my hand recreate his hand and forge his signature, but then erase it. So take it a step further, and kind of like a metaphor for what's happening with our current election. I also was thinking about the historical work of the erased de Kooning by Robert Rauschenberg, how Rauschenberg went and bought this drawing from de Kooning and proceeded to erase it. The process of making erased 45, I thought, was very cathartic, but it was also taxing. Thanks for visiting me here today in my studio. I hope you enjoyed it.